Just before I launch into this, I just sort of pick up on something that Cheryl said. Has Cheryl done a runner, has she? Looks like it. Cheryl mentioned work-life balance, and that is a very important thing to try and get your head around. It probably has a different connotation at the university than it does in some other environments. I've learned a word today that I didn't realise existed, which is Quidditch. I thought that was Harry Potter. It is? Well, I can't imagine you guys riding broomsticks around chasing things, you know. Maybe it is. I learn stuff every day. This is my hobby. Brett might go, you lucky so-and-so. I get to do that maybe half a dozen times a year. So if you think work-life balance is that you'll play rugby on Mondays and perhaps you go tennis on Thursdays and then do something on Saturdays and Sundays and work 30 hours of paid employment and do four courses at uni, you probably need to reconsider your life balance because you won't have one. So you need to do stuff. You need to do stuff that's outside of this place or you will go insane. But you just can't expect that to be huge volumes of stuff. Okay, next week, getting to the university will be a little bit more difficult. There will be traffic galore. If you intend to drive up from the South Lakes area, then the traffic will stop probably getting on towards Glendale. If you're coming from Maitland down the Link Road, expect to pull up just as you pull off the freeway. If you're coming down the main road, expect yourselves to stop around Sandgate. Okay? If you're coming in from Hamilton, Hamilton's probably a reasonable place to park. Once you get in the gate, it's a bit of a parking lot. It really is hard. You'll have all driven in here probably this morning because of the rain and everything. Going, there's plenty of parks. What are they worried about? Brett made the comment there are 4,000 students doing engineering. Well, we are the second smallest faculty. So by the time you get 20,000 students, all with a 9 a.m. scheduled class trying to get in on the week one, you might imagine it gets a little disastrous. With that in mind, if you're in Maitland, Hamilton, you can catch a train. There's a big, big thing. It runs on rails, carries lots of people. If you're in Jesmond or Shortland, the things on the end of your legs are very useful at times. Katara, Cardiff, ride a push bike, whatever, carpool. There are a number of carpool parking spaces around the campus. So if you can manage to bludge a few friends into your cars, you can get more chance of finding a car park. I urge all of these things on a completely selfish basis that I drive from South Lakes and I don't like pulling up at Glendale. So if you can find any other way to do it, please do. Couple of guidelines to succeed in your degrees. Be positive. You know, if you walk into an exam going, oh, I'm going to fail, well, you probably will. But take a positive view on life. Be proactive, right? We are going to shovel feed you with information on a daily basis. If something doesn't make sense to you and you work at it and it still doesn't make sense to you, don't leave it until next week because there'll be four more shovelfuls of information to deal with. You get something, you don't understand, you do some work on it, you go to pass, whatever else, and it doesn't make sense, come and talk to the academics. Be a little bit professional. The last couple of years, you get, Brett and the rest of the academics, we'll get emails from students, and it looks like a cross between text speak and a 90s rapper has sent us this email. And you read it and you go, I don't know what you want. So if you can sort of reread your email and make sure it's actually using real words and whole sentences and has a point, you might get a much more succinct answer back from that. All of your programs will have one of these things. It's called a PEC, a Program Enrollment Checklist. This just happens to be for electrical, doesn't matter. It shows you the layout of your program. If you want to succeed, follow the program. We see so many students who end up in what we call at-risk situations because they failed Maths 1, they enrolled into Maths 2, and guess what? They failed Maths 2, so then they've enrolled in Maths 3. It doesn't make a lot of sense. Okay, so you need to try and follow your program. Don't go back, or don't leave a first-year course until you get to fourth year because, A, you'll go to sleep when you go back to it because the rate of data flow will be so slow compared to what you're used to in fourth year. But it just causes all sorts of issues. So try and knock it off year by year as you go. What you might need to think about, a lot of you might have just left home. You've come to the university, yeah, we're out of home, da-da-da-da-da. Lots of things are changing. We don't take a role in class, as a general rule. You're expected to turn up. If I have a lecture theatre of this size, which we often will have, I won't know if this gent in the red cap turns up or not, unless he wears the same red cap every day. And if I can actually focus that distance in the theatre. So I'm not going to particularly take a role because it takes too long in an environment this size. If you don't hand an assignment in, I'm not necessarily going to know that the John Smith, who's John? I don't know, he's got the zero. Move on. Okay? Do them, hand them in. It can make a difference to your final grade. One of my PhD students was saying the other day he didn't do one 5% assessment item during his career and he regretted it because it cost him a HD. That's so sad for him. More sad if it actually means the difference between you passing and failing a course. Okay? Take a copy of your assignments. Please, I tell everybody to do this. The story, a student said, look, I've handed it in. I stuck it under your door when you weren't there. And I said, well, I haven't got it. I can't do anything. It turned out they'd stuck it under the door next to my office, which happened to have a filing cabinet up against it. And I found it out 3 years later because the person from that office moved their filing cabinet and said, is this yours? But the person hadn't taken a copy. I had no idea. What could I do? So take a copy of the things. Get yourselves into a bit of a study habit. We sort of say, look, yeah, you need to work 40 hours a week, 50 hours a week, if you're going to do a full-time load. Clearly in week one, we're all busy going, g'day, I'm Bill, welcome to the university. There's not going to be a real lot of work for you to do. There will be weeks where you'll have 80 hours worth of work to do. And particularly if you don't schedule yourselves appropriately, you'll get unavoidable alignments of assignments. You'll have 5 assignments due in 1 week. You were too busy off playing Quidditch, apparently. And all of a sudden it's, oh, damn, I've got to do all-nighters all this week to get these assignments done. How do we differentiate between a P and a HP, a pass and a high distinction? It's really effort. I've looked at the data and there's almost zero correlation with what people have come in with to how they go in courses. It's a shotgun. And it's really about those that come in and go, right, I'm here, I'm going to work, I'm going to do stuff, I'm going to set myself targets. They'll be fine. And you can have the other people that are too busy playing Quidditch and they'll end up down the toilet. Sure, I shouldn't pick up Quidditch all the time, should I? Use your tutors and your academics. We are actually nice people, if you ask. Come around and see us. If you can't understand something, ask some questions. Your tutors, we pay them to be there to help you. Don't just let the tutor fall asleep at the front of a class. Make them work. So the important things, don't procrastinate. Seize the day, just do it. Whatever your favourite saying is, you just need to do it today and move on. Sometimes things don't go the way you plan. If things go wrong, if things are going south, you need to tell us. Are you right over there? Took me a while to find those pictures, I'll tell you. Unfortunately, you might think the academics are a bit harsh and callous because we're unlikely to see this. If you walk in and your leg's been bitten off by a shark, we won't notice until we slip over on the blood pool. Okay? We're just a little busy most of the time. If you suffer from something, it could be epilepsy, it could be hemorrhoids, I don't know, anything. You need to tell somebody if it's important, okay? Because we can't help you unless we know. Why would epilepsy be an issue? Well, if you're doing mechanical engineering, you're going to be using a lathe. And unfortunately, a lathe chuck spinning around with some epilepsy people tends to force them into a seizure. And having you fall into a lathe in the middle of a workshop session is not real good. There's a lot of paperwork, there's a lot of mess. Okay, so we need you to tell us these things. If you need to know something about how the university works, you probably want to ask somebody. And the person you have lunch with every day may not actually be the oracle of the university's policy library. Okay, so you might want to actually go and ask an academic or one of the support staff that's around the place to say, look, I don't know what I need to do about this. Can you point me in a direction? And again, generally, they will help you hand over fist. You need to prioritise your time. Now, you might get a really cool assignment that you really get stuck into, but getting 10 out of 10, and it's only worth 2% of your final grade, is a bit silly if you forget about all these other assignments that are worth 20%. So you need to be a little bit strict with yourselves. You go, look, it's a really fun assignment, but I'm only going to spend this much time on it because I need to move on. Learn to file stuff, right? Work out where things are in your head as much as in your physical space. Need to draw material from different courses as you go through the program. You might see your program as individual blocks of information. They're not. They are all integrated. We're giving you skills for a reason. PowerPoints. Death by PowerPoint. You will get used to PowerPoints everywhere you go. They are a wonderful tool for me because I can put some notes on here that give me a prompt what I need to talk about, and I can get up here and I can talk to my heart's content about that. When you get home and you download the PowerPoints, you go, what the hell was McBride talking about? I can't remember. Take a pencil or a pen, write some notes. Leave your laptops at home to a large extent because invariably you can see the back row all have their laptops, their iPads, whatever, and they're invariably doing Facebook. Doesn't really help the learning process. Learn how to use your tools, right? They are quite useful at times. Not to be negative, if you fail a course, it happens. The first failure is like a scratch on mum's new car. It really, really hurts. Okay, they do happen. Move on. What you need to do is then re-enroll in that course at its next offering. Don't sort of go, oh, look, I'll come back to it in a couple of years' time. Okay? Try and understand why you failed. Was it too much rugby league training? Maybe I need to cut back on rugby league training. Did I not understand the background material? Maybe I need to go and review some of that before I get back into it again. The key is put more effort in the second time round, not less. A lot of people fall into the trap, well, you know, I got 46% the first time through, I only need to put 4% effort into it and I'll get a 50. And of course, the next time through they get 28%, and it just sort of spirals. If you do fail a course, it stays on your transcript forever and a day. Okay? If you withdraw from a course up until the week of Stuvac, the last week of lectures, it will not appear in your transcript. Okay? So it's important, don't let these things roll over. If you get a heap of fails in one semester, for whatever reason, you'll have to appear before myself as part of the appeals committee to say, well, you know, what's going wrong? And it's really there just to help you guys. All of your programs have general electives. Use them with some care. You can do whatever you want. Anything on campus can be used as a general elective. Be strategic. You might say, guitar one, how hard could it be? Now, if you happen to be the lead guitarist from Led Zeppelin, it's probably going to be fairly cool for you to do that course. If you're like me and your fingers span four strings in one time, you're probably not going to go very well at guitar one. You're going to actually have to be able to do something with it. So just be a little bit careful on some of these things. If you're a mechanical, civil engineering, steel design, it's not going to be terribly hard. It's going to make you work, but it might actually be quite useful for you. So think about some of these things. What are academics besides scary old people that stand up here? We're basically you guys in 20 years' time, right? We've done our degree. We've done probably a number of years of industrial experience, worked in industry, for example. We do a PhD, which is, you know, 3.5 years full-time study, doing research, and we get to write a book. So all of us have got our own little books on our bookshelves, probably never opened since we handed them in. That's what we do. We do all sorts of stuff. We're involved in funded and unfunded research, grant preparations, admin duties, a little bit there at the bottom, course prep, delivery, quality assurance, community service. Throughout the entire year, about 10% of our load is teaching. Okay? Just keep that in mind when you're chasing us around the place at times. I've told you, if you've got any issues, go and talk to your academics. Okay? Highly encouraged. Most of us will stop whatever we're doing. We may have meetings to go to, we may have other things that are really, really pressing, so we might have to chop you a little bit short. But if you've come and you said, look, I really don't understand this electric circuit. Brett, I've been bashing the head against this for a week. I don't understand. I've tried all these methods. It doesn't work. Brett will bend over backwards to try and help you understand that material. If you walk in and go, I don't know what's going on. Well, what have you done? Oh, nothing. I just don't understand it. Then you might get a shorter version.